being bullied could have something to do with your genes. And I'm going to tell you how that works.
Does your DNA make you popular? This is the University of the Netherlands.
All of us remember from school how some of our classmates had lots of friends and other people stood more at the sideline. Some children were mean to others and some were the victims of such bullying. Some children had the same small group of best friends all throughout secondary school. And others were like social butterflies, constantly making new friends. Some were overlooked and others massively popular, no matter which group they entered. As adults, we probably observe the same, even if it is not in this condensed and obvious form anymore. What makes us different in how we approach and handle social situations and how we are perceived and treated by the people around us? Most of us instinctively think that the ability to interact with others, to be popular, is in the person. Maybe because they were always like this. This would mean that there is some innate explanation for social behavior. But could your DNA really play a role in this and affect your friendships and social standing in a group? I am an associate professor, and I do research on how genes influence social behavior. How would that work? Let's try and trace the pathway from the DNA to a behavior. Humans have tens of thousands of genes that are made up of DNA, which carries the genetic information in our body. Some of those genes pass on instructions to create amino acids, which are the building blocks for the proteins in our body. Proteins, in turn, are the building blocks for hormones and neurotransmitters, the chemicals in our brains and our bodies that regulate how happy, awake, frightened, or stressed we feel. These kinds of emotional reactions of our body to the environment likely also have an effect on our behavior. So even though there are a lot of steps between the DNA and the behavior, both are actually linked in a biologically meaningful way. But does that really mean that our DNA influences our friendships and our social standing in a group? Let me tell you how researchers go about finding out more about this. Well, one possibility is by looking at twins. Simply put, one compares identical twins, who share 100% of their genetic makeup, to non-identical twins, who share approximately half of their genetic makeup. Because they're all twins, we assume that the two identical twins grew up in the same environment and that the non-identical twins grew up in the same environment. If we now see that the identical twins are much more similar to one another on a behavior or on a trait than the non-identical twins, we conclude that the similarity in identical twins has to be caused by genes, because this is the part where they are more similar than non-identical twins. So for instance, imagine two identical twins both get into fights a lot. And also imagine two non-identical twins where one fights a lot, but the other does not. We conclude that the identical twins are a lot more similar on that aggressive behavior than the non-identical twins. Now that we think that the environmental conditions for identical twins are just as similar as they are for non-identical twins, we reason that it is the differences in DNA among the non-identical twins that explain why they show different behavior. Over the past decades, there have been a lot of twin studies which found that identical twins are more similar to each other than non-identical twins on pretty much everything that would be of interest to behavioral and social scientists. This includes behaviors such as aggression or prosocial behavior, or whether and how much someone smokes, but also traits such as neuroticism and even norms and values, like whether or not someone is religious. On the whole, we can say that about 50% of the differences between us as individuals in traits and behaviors come about because of the differences in our DNA. Scientists have also compared twins on whether they bully others and are bullied themselves. bullying and victimization are important concepts in social development and can carry a lot of weight for one's position in the classroom. What is really fascinating is that not only bullying, which in essence is aggressive behavior toward a classmate or other peer of similar age, is genetically influenced, but also being a victim. This latter finding is really fascinating because it means that even things that happen to us are partly driven by our own DNA. At the moment, we can only speculate why this is. A possibility might be that certain traits or behaviors that are genetically influenced and are known for putting a child at risk for being disliked and bullied by others might explain what is going on. This could be, for example, the way a child looks that is not approved by the group, but also being very shy or impulsive. These are traits that we know are genetically influenced and that we know also are often not so handy for becoming popular. I want to touch upon another thing. When I talk about the role of DNA for social behavior and how we form and experience relationships with others, I often get asked whether this means that there is a particular gene for bullying or a particular gene for popularity. This is really not the case. Each single snippet of DNA has such a tiny influence on human traits and on behavior that there is no one snippet that determines whether or not someone is popular or a victim of bullying. Still, of course, we want to know a bit more than what twin studies can tell us. And luckily, there have been some very exciting developments in the field of genetics in the past few years that will hopefully help us understand better how our DNA is linked to behavior. These developments are based on so-called genome-wide association studies, in which researchers measure the links between lots and lots of snippets of DNA and a so-called phenotype. Such a phenotype can be anything. How many years someone went to school, for instance, or a score on a questionnaire that is asking about aggressive behaviors. Researchers look for patterns. Do people with the same phenotype, for example, high levels of aggressive behavior, have the same pattern on a DNA snippet? In other words, does the particular snippet look the same for people who are similar on a phenotype? And after running such a study, we know for each snippet of DNA how much it is related to the phenotype we are interested in, such as years of education or aggressive behavior. And we can combine these many pieces of information to calculate a risk score that combines the information of all bits of DNA that we looked at. Such a score then basically describes the combined genetic chance for someone to stay in education for many years, or combined genetic risk for someone to behave aggressively towards others. We cannot change someone's DNA. So what can we do with this information? It is important to keep in mind that the genetic prediction of risk for aggressive behavior is by no means deterministic. Even if someone has a high genetic risk, the environment in which this child grows up in plays a very important role. And this is what my own research focuses on. Together with colleagues, I work with a TRAILS study. TRAILS stands for Tracking Adolescents' Individual Life Survey. For almost 20 years, the TRAILS research team has followed young people to understand their development and capture their experiences in their teens and during early adulthood. Many of those young people are now have children of their own, and we are very fortunate to include these children in our research. So when we hear that someone in the TRAILS study had a baby, we ask if we can come over for a visit. And there we interview the parents and we ask them to play with the child so we can study the differences in how young parents interact with their infants. We also come back for additional visits when the children are 2.5 and 4.5 years old. And we do lots of cool stuff with them, like little experiments or interviews with hand puppets. Of course, because we are interested in the genetic side of things, we also collect DNA. We do that by taking swabs of the cells inside the mouth from both the child and the parents. Having genetic information on both generations is really useful. For instance, imagine a child who has inherited a genetic risk for aggressive behavior. The genes that this child has inherited and that are related to the child's increased risk for aggression are obviously also carried by the parents and influence the parents' aggressive behavior, not only towards others, but probably also towards the child. This could be by being cold towards the child, losing patience when something goes wrong, or generally by not making sure that the child feels loved and welcome. These parenting behaviors are environmental factors that have been linked to child aggression as well. As such, this child has a double risk for being aggressive, coming from the genes and the environment. In my research, we don't only have DNA information of the child, but also so much knowledge on their upbringing and home environment during their early years, and even on their parents' development during their teens and early 20s. So we can really zoom in on how the genetic risk of a child for a trait plays out under different environmental conditions. So if we take the child again with a high genetic risk for aggression, and we know that this child goes to a school where children fight a lot and teachers are not really interested, the risk for this child to bully others is probably higher than for a child with the same genetic risk, but who goes to a school with a more peaceful and caring climate. Let me give you another example. We know that child overweight and obesity are a growing problem. From twin and genetic research, we know that overweight and obesity are genetically influenced. But environmental conditions, such as how close someone lives to fast food restaurants and family meals high in sugar and fat, also contribute to child overweight and obesity. If we now know who carries a high genetic risk for obesity, we can maybe make extra sure that these children are supported in choosing healthy foods and engage in sports and physical activity. Putting it differently, the combination of genetic and environmental risk places some children in a particularly bad position, and it might be appropriate to intervene early in their lives and create opportunities for them to flourish regardless. Although such kinds of interventions that are based on genetic information are really not the reality yet, this kind of research is definitely important to support all children to grow up healthy and happy. Let's go back to the playground of our schools. Do you remember whether you were the shy kid on the sideline, or the social butterfly, or the popular one? Did you ever imagine that this might have been influenced by your genes? It turns out it does, for a considerable part, actually. Of course, there's not one single gene that determines whether you're popular, a bully, or will be bullied. But we do know that genetics, aside from the environment, plays an important role. Future research will show whether we will ever use the genetic information to help some children. But we need to keep in mind that genes will not determine someone's life. When we talk about such complex social behaviors as popularity or bullying, genes might load the gun, but eventually it's the environment that pulls the trigger. Thank you.